guys, we'll start. Before we start, this is the last day of the lecture, and I don't know whether I'll be able to complete the Kerr shadow. The derivations are quite long, but even if we can learn about the Kerr black hole, I think it will be fine. Later, you can look at any of the good references. So one of the very good reference, classic reference, is this Chandrasekhar's book, Mathematical Theory of Black Holes. If you look at the portion which discusses the geodesic of Kerr black hole, particularly the null geodesic, it is very, very interesting, and very explicit derivations are there. Okay, so I urge you to look at it. Okay, and I'll also give another reference today. Okay, good. So let's start. So what we were looking at from the last class is the observers in Kerr black hole, Kerr space time. And then we talk about what we call the static observer. Okay, static observer. The four velocity of static observers are proportional to T alpha. Okay, and I told you these observers are static. That means they are sitting at some point. Okay, so at every hour you can think of series of observers sitting. Neither they are moving in theta direction nor they are moving in phi direction. Of course, they are moving in time. That is obvious. You can't stop in time. Okay, so their wall line is the wall line of a static observer. Good. So what you may ask, so first of all, these observers are not geodesic observers. It's obvious because they have to work against the action of the gravity. So they must be carrying rockets. So at each point from infinity to towards the central object, at each point you have to apply force to keep yourself static. Okay. And let's see how long you can continue to be static. Okay. So static observer exists as long as such observers, such guys exist. But there, as long as U alpha is timeline. Okay. So that means I'll be able to normalize U alpha to be minus one. See, if they're space-like, that means such observers are not physical observer. Okay, you have to need, there is no physical amount of force, finite amount of force you can use to make this observer stay at a point. Okay, good. Now, to check how long they will be static, you have to calculate that how long gamma, what is the constant on the gamma? So this constant tell you G alpha beta U alpha U beta is equal to minus one. Okay. So therefore this is GTT UT square equal to minus one. Because remember U alpha is gamma T alpha, which is equal to gamma Z, sorry, my mistake. 1 0 0 0. Okay. It's only in the time direction, the static observer. So therefore only UT exists, and UT is basically gamma square. So we'll have GTT. We have already written down the value of GTT, but let's continue. So this is gamma square GTT equal to minus one. Okay. So therefore you have a condition that gamma square equal to minus one by GTT. Okay. Good. Okay. Note that GTT, we have defined. Let's write down what is GTT. GTT is 1 minus 2 MR by rho square, where rho equal to R square plus A square cos square theta. Okay. Now, see immediately, let us know first, before we go to the Kerr case, let us first see what happens for the Schwarzschild case. Okay. How long we can have static observers in Schwarzschild? Take the case A equal to zero, no angular momentum, which is like Schwarzschild. In that case, gamma square equal to minus one minus 2m by r. Okay. So you see that as long as gamma square, this quantity, okay, this is, so GTT, as long as GTT is positive, I'll be able to maintain UT to be timeline. Okay. Once GTT shift is sign, U alpha from minus one will become plus one. So, and when GTT is zero, in that case, the UTET will be zero. So what it means is that, so let's write down U alpha. U alpha will be gamma is, so sorry, GTT is, note that there is a minus sign, GTT plus. So gamma equal to 1 by square root of 1 minus 2m by r. Okay. So note that I have U alpha equal to square root of 1 minus 2m by r, 1, 0, 0, 0. This is static observer at r equal to say r naught, okay, some constant value r naught, let's call it r naught, okay, for Schwarzschild black hole. Okay, now it is clear that at r equal to 2m, something strange will happen, okay? So let's understand what happens at r equal to 2m, okay? So what happens at r equal to 2m? Anybody? What happens to this short static observer at r equal to 2m? Is it possible to have a static observer at r equal to 2m? Anybody like to answer this question? Hello? Anybody? So there is a chat answer. It says it would inevitably fall to the black hole. Yeah, but one has to be a little careful. Suppose I go very close to the r equal to 2m, what is happening to this U alpha? Can I maintain U alpha to be time-like when I am inside r equal to 2m? And the answer is no, obviously. So U alpha will be time-like till r equal to 2m. Okay. Once I cross the r equal to 2m, I will not have time-like U alpha. There is no time-like U alpha because there this wanted, so this gamma square is positive because GTT is negative. This condition, if GTT is negative. So this condition is valid only for r greater than 2m. Okay. So therefore, I will not be able to get a time-like observer, and therefore, there is no static observer beyond, or rather not beyond is the not right word, inside r equal to 2m. This is exactly what you have learned, that once you go inside, you can't get static at r equal to m. You have to fall into it. To be static inside r equal to 2m, you have to move in a space-like direction. That is not allowed, okay? Clear? So therefore, it clearly means that till r equal to 2m up to horizon, in Schwarzschild case, I can have static observer. Inside r equal to 2m, I cannot have static observers, okay? Clear? So that's very good, okay? So it matches, so that means r equal to 2m, event horizon is also the static limit. What does static limit means? It is the limit beyond which we cannot obtain any static observer. Okay. So very good. So for Schwarzschild case, the static limit is exactly in the same place of the event horizon. Okay. Good. We understand. Now let's understand what happens for the Kerr case. Kerr case, GTT is rather minus 1 minus 2m, so this quantity, 2mr, by rho square, where rho square equal to r square plus a square cos square theta. Okay. Kerr case, it has a theta dependence because of the a. Good. Now, if I now demand, so now the static limit, that means limit till I will get, so note what is happening. I'm coming from infinity. At each point, I'm looking for static observer. Okay. I can continue up to certain r. After some r, however strong rocket I use, I have to fall into inside. Okay. There is no static observer possible. Okay. I have to be a little careful. I won't say the fall to inside. I will say that there is no static observer. You cannot stay in one place. okay, outside the central object. Okay, you cannot become static. And therefore, static limit is defined by the zero of this function. So therefore, 1 minus 2mr by rho square equal to 0. Okay. At that point, there will be no static observer beyond which. And if you do this calculation, you will see this will give you a differential, a simple algebraic equation, quadratic equation of this form. A square cos square theta equal to 0. And the solution of this equation is sometimes called R static limit as a function of theta equal to M plus minus. There's a plus minus, but I will only take the outer solution, okay? The larger root, okay? So I'll only taking the M square minus A square cos square theta, okay? But this is extremely important quantity to understand the properties of curved black hole. What it means is that at the beyond this point, okay, I will not have any static observer. Okay, so there are two possibilities exist. Either the observer beyond this point has to fall in, or it has to rotate with the hole. Okay, I'll come back to those possibilities. Okay, and this is called sometimes ergosphere. Okay. Let us understand what is this ergosphere. Okay, so let me again write. So static observer exists if and only if R greater than R static limit as a function of theta. Okay, R less than R SL function of theta, there is no static, sorry, my mistake. No static observer. Okay, this is an important point. Okay, and let us draw this curve. Okay, first of all, look, this is a theta dependent object. So therefore, R equal to RSL is not a sphere. Okay, because its radius depends on theta, M square minus A square cos square theta. Again, please note, if I put A equal to 0, RSL goes to 2m for the Schwarzschild case. Schwarzschild case, everything is 2m. Horizon is 2m, static limit is 2m, and that's all. Okay, good. So let's understand this, okay, what would happen. So let us now draw the contour of this surface, okay? So what, in order to draw, we have to be a little careful because R does not have, curve does not have spherical symmetry. So let's say I consider this as my z-axis, okay? And let's say this is some cross sections of the curved black hole. That means on this plane, only theta is changing. This is a phi cross section, okay? Phi equal to constant cross section of the curved black hole, okay? So on this plane, if this is the angle, is the theta. This is the theta angle. Because I measure angle from the z-axis, theta, okay? Of course, there is a phi plane, but I'm looking at a constant phi slice. So think of a tarbuj, okay, or watermelon. Take the constant phi slice. This is what you're looking at, okay? That surface, okay? An angle on that surface is the angle theta, okay? But of course, remember, there is a three-dimensional. It's actually, there is a phi slice also, phi direction also, which of course, I am not going to show you in this picture. Good. Now let's draw this surface on this slice, okay? Note that two points. When theta equal to 0, RSL is simply equal to 2m. And theta equal to pi by 2, RSL equal to m plus square root of m square minus a square, okay? So theta equal to 0, it is 2m. And theta equal to pi by 2, it has a value m plus m square minus a square. Okay, so let's plot this value. I wrote it exactly opposite. R equal to pi by 2, it has a value. R equal to pi by 2, it has a value 2 pi, and this is R equal to theta equal to 0. Sorry, my mistake. Because when theta is pi by 2, there is no such term, then I'll get 2m. Okay, if theta is 0, then cos theta is equal to 1, then I'll get RSL equal to m square minus s square. Okay, good. So let me try to plot how this ergosphere looks like in this plane. Okay. Excuse me. Okay. So before we plot, remember this angle theta. So let's point this point. So this is theta equal to zero. So this is the object at theta equal to zero. This is m, this length. And theta equal to pi by 2, this object is 2m. Okay. So not, let me here. Sorry, my drawing capability is a little bit bad. So forgive me, it is somewhere here. Okay. So this is theta equal to pi by 2 when this is 2m. Okay. So it means this radius is minimum value is this quantity. This is minimum at theta equal to 0. And maximum is this at theta equal to pi by 2. So it starts with theta equal to minimum value at theta equal to 0. Okay. And goes to its maximum value at theta equal to pi by 2. Okay. So that means I need to cancel this. Forgive my drawing, guys. So this is m, okay, sorry, 2m. Again, at h point, this is RSL as a function of theta, okay? This angle is theta. Similarly, then again, it starts from 2m and then it decreases to some value, again, this quantity. Again, by symmetry in the other direction also, there is this object. Okay. So this is the cross section, okay? So inside, so outside, this is r greater than RSL theta, static observer can exist. Inside, r less than RSL theta, no static observer. And this surface is called Argosphere, or the static limit. Good. So once inside the ergosphere, there are only two possibilities. Either you have to fall into the black hole to the central object, or another possibility exists that you are not static, but rather stationary. Okay. So let us now understand, what is a stationary observer? What we call stationary observer. So unlike static observers, stationary observers are not static at a point. They are actually rotating with the hole. They don't have an R component. That means they are at a constant distance from the, one has to be a little again careful, constant value of the radial coordinate from the central object, but they have component in the phi direction and obviously in the t direction. Okay. And last time we discussed that stationary observer has four velocity, some gamma, t alpha into some omega into phi alpha. Again, this gamma and the gamma in earlier case are different. Okay. These are the just same notation. Okay. Okay. Depending on what observer you choose, gamma will be different. Okay. And where T alpha equal to 1000, phi alpha equal to 0001, and then omega is basically u phi by ut equal to d phi dt, the angular velocity. So this observer is rotating with the hole. Okay, it is not falling. It is keeping constant value in R. Okay, good. Excellent. Now let's go ahead and try to see what we can do, how long we have a static observer. Okay, how long the static observer can be there. Okay, so question is how long we can obtain a static observer. Sorry, a stationary observer. Again, let us start, understand what we are doing. we are starting with large distance, for we are coming to each R, stopping at each R. We may ask that, is there a static observer in this R? That means how much force is required? What is the acceleration required to keep static at this point? And we have seen, once we reach the static limit, there will be no static observer inside the static limit. That means you will not able to obtain a physical rocket in which there is a static observer. Now we are asking the same question. We start with infinity. At each R, we say, okay, boss, we are not interested in static observer. We are asking, can we have a stationary observer at this stage? Okay. That means an observer which is actually rotating. It has a phi component. Okay. It has a T component, as four velocity has a T component, as well as a phi component. Okay. But not R or theta. Okay. Now, question is, how long I can continue to get, how long I can get, how close to the central object I can get a static observer. Okay. A stationary observer. Again, the condition is same. U alpha to be minus one if I want time-like observer, and the condition will be gamma squared equal to minus G phi phi. Just calculate this quantity just by putting the metric and everything. 2 omega omega plus GTT G phi phi, and this must be positive. Okay, as long as this is positive, I will obtain a time-like stationary observer. So that means that each point R, at every R, find a suitable omega such that gamma to the power minus 2 is positive. Okay. So at every R, what is in your hand? In your hand, the thing to adjust is omega. Okay. So at every R, find the omega for which you can become stationary. Okay. Now, I leave it to you. It's quite trivial to show that this condition on omega, it's a quadratic equation. You can put the values of GTT and G phi phi for the Kerr black hole. You can show this requires omega to obey a condition omega minus less than omega less than omega plus. That means omega has to be chosen within omega minus and omega plus, where omega plus minus is given by this value, omega small omega plus minus delta to the power half rho square by sigma sine theta. Okay. So there is a band. You cannot choose omega beyond that band. Okay. As long as you are within this band, okay, greater than omega minus, but less than omega plus, you're perfectly fine. You can choose a omega within that band for every R, and in that R, if you move with that angular velocity omega, you will remain static. Okay, it's perfectly fine. You have a time-like observer. Good. And how long you can continue to do this? This can continue. Omega plus equal to omega minus. So till omega plus equal to omega minus, you will always have a omega for which at that R you can rotate and keep stationary. Okay. In fact, if you put the value of small omega, remember in the Kerr metric, we have last time shown that small omega is given by 2mAr by sigma. Okay. And using this, you can obtain that omega plus minus equal to 2mAr by sigma plus minus delta to the power half rho square by sigma sine theta. Again, Kerr metric, the metric component are cumbersome. It is always better when you do a calculation, you keep the metric component in a separate sheet. Okay, so we can always do the calculation and check. Good. Excellent. Now let's see what happens if you had very large distance. Okay. Consider the case. To understand this limit, consider the case r tends to infinity. Okay, that means you are inside, you are far away from the black hole. Okay, so one would expect in that case the properties will be similar to that of the flat space time, because you are far away from the black hole. Newton's gravitational law goes as 1 by r square, the effect of the gravity goes down, and you can also show, you see that Kerr metric reduces to a flat space time metric, Schwarzschild metric also reduces to a flat space time metric at very large distance from the hole. Okay, good. So in a flat space time, what is the limit on your velocity? The limit on your velocity is plus minus c. Either you can have a plus c or minus c velocity. Okay, so that means, or in our notation, plus minus 1. Okay, so if r is in some sense the distance from the central point, then velocity should go as r into angular velocity, order of magnitude wise. Okay, so therefore one would expect that r into omega in a flat space time available to be minus c to plus c. Okay, so let's see what will happen. If you take your omega plus minus and take the limit r goes to infinity, take a particular theta for simplicity, okay, sine theta equal to 1. Okay, in that case you will see that this goes as r square by r to the power 4, that is 1 by r, okay, with a plus minus 1. And you will see that in that case r into omega plus minus goes to actually plus minus 1. Okay, or rather if you invoke c not equal to 1, you will get plus minus c. That means all the ranges of velocities are available to you in flat space time, and all the possible angular velocities are available to you. You can always, at every r in flat very far distance, you will be able to get a stationary observer, which is expected. Okay, so let's go ahead. So therefore, at r goes to infinity, I have a range plus 1 to minus 1 for the omega plus and omega minus into r. Okay, good. Also note omega minus is equal to omega minus delta to the power half rho square by sigma sine theta. So there exists a condition for which omega minus equal to 0, there is r, is an r for which this equal to 0. Okay, I leave it to you to calculate that when this happens, of course it means omega equal to delta to the power half rho square sigma sine theta. Okay, you can use this value of omega. Okay, this equation, this is a bit tedious algebra, but you should be able to prove it. This happens when r equal to r sl theta. So exactly at the static limit, omega minus becomes 0. In fact, you can show omega minus is negative till r less than rsl, r greater than rsl theta. And it is actually positive if r less than rsl theta. Good. And omega plus is always positive. Okay, so let's draw a diagram to understand what is going on. So what I'll plot here, I will plot r omega. Okay. So this, I go to r goes to infinity. So this is r goes to infinity, very large distance. What are the allowed values of omega plus r omega at infinity? The allowed values are, remember we have discussed, plus 1 and minus 1. This is plus 1, this is minus 1 for r. So if you are at a very large distance, this is the band. Okay, and so this is the allowed band. Choose any omega for this, that particular r. Okay, you can obtain a stationary observer rotating with the hole. So omega minus, if I plot omega minus, increases, because it is negative initially, increases, and it becomes zero at some point. Okay, and we have discussed that this point is nothing but, this is the point where R equal to R SL theta. Okay. And after that point, omega minus is positive. So this is the plot of omega minus. What about omega plus? Allowed value, the omega plus is initially plus one. The allowed upper limit decreases. At some point, it becomes equal to the omega plus. So let's call that point R equal to RH. Why H will come back to, okay? So that means beyond R at R equal to RH, omega plus is equal to omega minus. Okay. So if R less than RH, we have no omega, no allowed omega that can make gamma to the power minus 2 positive. So R less than RH, no stationary observer. This is remarkable. That means there is a finite value of R which is inside the ergosphere. After that, you cannot even have stationary observer. See, after ergosphere, you cannot have static observer. But you can still decide, no, I will not fall into the black hole. I will rotate. Okay, keep a constant distance. But once you cross that RH, it seems you cannot even have a stationary observer. Then you have no more option in other than to fall in. Okay? Clear? You have to fall in. There has to be R component and it will take you down. Okay? There is no way you can have a observer which is stationary inside R equal to RH. And condition for R equal to RH will be omega plus equal to omega minus. Okay? And let's calculate where omega plus equal to omega minus will be. And the condition will be immediately you can see where delta equal to zero. That means R square. So what is delta? R square. So let's look at delta. In the previous class, we have looked at delta. This is equation 5. If you remember in the previous class, we talked about delta. Let me go ahead again. Here is delta. Okay. So this is R square minus 2mr plus a square equal to 0. And we are only interested in the outer root, the maximum root. And that is called R horizon equal to m plus square root of m square minus a square. Amazingly, there is no theta dependence here. Okay. So let us understand what is going on. Okay, by drawing a picture. Okay. So again, this is again a constant phi slice. This is z axis. Okay. What we have found that ergosphere is something like this. Okay. It goes like this. Okay. This is RSL. Okay. So at this is at any point is RSL theta. Okay. Which is equal to m plus square root of m square minus a square cos square theta. Now, remember, if you clearly remember that this point, this was equal to exactly this term came. Okay. I should not have put in this curves. I don't know why I put this curves. Okay. But what I actually mean is an elliptical shape. Okay. So let me be a little careful here. It will be something like this. Okay. Okay. That means the radius decreases. Okay. I don't know why I put this kind of figure. Okay. Remember, this point is exactly at RH. M minimum value is m plus square root of m minus a square. So that means if I plot the RH value, let's call this will be exactly this, where at the theta equal to zero, it will coincide, okay, with the ergosphere, and then otherwise ergosphere will be outside. So this quantity is R equal to RH equal to M plus square root of M square minus A square. Notice RSL at theta equal to 0 is equal to RH. RSL at theta equal to 0 as well as pi equal to RH. Okay. Clear? Good. So at this point, ergosphere and the horizon match with each other. But otherwise, in general point, this is a general point, RH is less than RSL theta. And equality happens only at the two poles, okay? At z equal to, at theta equal to 0 and theta equal to pi, okay? Good. So it means we now have a beautiful structure. Starting from the infinity, I can have static observer till ergosphere. Once I'm inside the ergosphere here, no static, no static observer, but stationary, yes, but stationary. But here, neither static, nor stationary. Okay. So therefore, R equal to RH is something like a stationary limit. You have no option but to fall in, okay? And this R equal to RH equal to M plus square root of M square minus A square. This is called, this is the event horizon. Event horizon. How do I know this is the event horizon? Of course, I can't prove it. The idea is, again, to construct the Kruskal construction exactly like the Schwarzschild case, at least the Eddington-Finkelstein kind of coordinate, and understand once you inside the R equal to RH, you will not be able to come back, okay, by drawing the light cones, okay? That is not true for R equal to RSL. You can go inside RSL and come back, okay? And that has important implications, okay? Something called Penrose processes, okay? But R equal to RH, once you inside, the light cone structure is such, you cannot come back, okay? So that is the true horizon, okay? So one important thing to notice is that for Schwarzschild case, the static limit and the event horizon are exactly at the same place, R equal to 2m. But for the Kerr case, when the space-time is stationary but not static, the static limit surface, okay, which is the ergosphere, is different from the stationary limit surface, that is the horizon. Okay, so this is a very, very important distinction of the stationary versus static space time, Kerr versus spherically symmetric black hole. That for Kerr case, the ergosphere is a different surface, and there is a region beyond which I can have static observer, I cannot have static observer, but I can have stationary observer. Okay, so it's important. Good. So this is more or less our structure of Kerr black hole. It's a cumbersome but intriguing structure. It is widely believed that astrophysical scenarios, the rotating black holes, the space-time outside is Kerr black hole. All the data we have today, including astrophysical data, event horizon telescope data, as well as gravitational physics, gravitational waves data, strongly suggest that all the data is highly consistent with a Kerr black hole with rotation as well as mass, okay? So therefore, it is the most important, physically important space-time of general relativity, okay? Now I'll stop here before I go to the null geodesics in Kerr. I will stop for the questions. Let me look at the questions. Oh. Good. Yes. Imagine two observers falling into black hole at the same rate, okay? They are beyond or less than, wouldn't you see these each other at rest? Okay, one has to be little careful in saying that. Look, once you have to be careful in saying that, because proper time is perfectly sense, okay? But when you say they are in rest, once they cross the horizon, you can talk about a single trajectory. They can communicate to each other using the light rays also. But you have to say that the measuring the velocity of one with respect to other, they have to communicate to light ray, okay? So if they're freely falling observer, if they have a distance, that separation distance will increase because of the geodesic deviation. Okay. So those things has to be taken into account in this calculation. So I cannot have an instant answer of this, but those things has to be considered. For the case determinant of R max A cos theta, curved black hole without ergosphere will still have an angular momentum. Oh yes, of course. So for example, I can have, so this is an important point. In fact, you look at here is M square is less than A square. Okay. Then I cannot have an event horizon. Okay. I cannot have an event horizon. So what it means is that the ergosphere does not exist. If ergosphere does not exist, then there is no static limit. I can have static limit to till everywhere. Okay. Is it clear? There is no static limit anymore. Okay. You're right. There is no static limit because this is always positive. There is no point. If you start with a positive, gamma square will always remain positive. It will never become zero. Okay. Similarly, you can have a condition when there it is all the horizon doesn't exist. Okay. Is it clear? So there is no stationary limit also. Good. So we have understood the space-time structure of curved black hole. I request you look at any standard reference which has, so for example, Relativist Toolkit will give you step-by-step construction of the Kruskal diagram for curved black hole. You can look at Townsend, which will also give you Townsend review, which will give you construction of the Penrose diagram for curved black hole, which will actually prove to you beyond doubt that R equal to RH surface is the event horizon, okay? Otherwise you have to take my word into it, okay? But remember this point that this picture is in a phi equal to constant plane, okay? So you have to actually rotate this picture, okay? To get in the phi direction to get the full three dimensional view, okay? It's kind of a football inside a tarbuj, okay? To be very crude, okay? So ergosphere is like a surface of a tarbuj, watermelon. Inside the watermelon, there is a ball, which is the horizon. Okay. The area of the horizon is 4 pi r square plus a square. Okay. Is it physically possible to have A greater than M? Good question. Well, it's a solution. Okay. It's an acceptable solution of general relativity to have a naked singularity. Okay. In that case, it's the singularity is naked. What question you should ask is that if I give you a solution where there is no naked singularity, there is a horizon. Can I add little bit of angular momentum to make it naked? This is a perfectly valid question. So for example, you can start with a condition that M square equal to S square. That is M equal to A. Okay. So therefore, this is called an extremal curved black hole. There is only one RH equal to M in that case. Now you may say that I'll give you a little bit of mass and little bit of angular momentum, a little bit more angular momentum. So let's say you had a mass small m and angular momentum, let's say delta m and angular momentum delta a to this hole. Okay, you add it. But subject to the condition that m plus delta m is less than q, sorry, a plus delta a. That means the final state, there is no horizon. You understand this question that you start with a extremal curved black hole, M equal to A, you add a mass and angular momentum, rotating particle. Okay. So you add energy as well as angular momentum, but such a way that this condition is true. Then in the final state, the final A is greater than the final M. So you don't have a horizon. So you start with a perfectly valid solution with horizon, add a little bit of particle and have a solution when there is no horizon. Is this a possible? And if you can create it, this will be a counter example to the cosmic censorship conjecture. Okay, the weak cosmic censorship conjecture, which says you cannot create naked singularity out of a regular solution. Okay, the answer to this question is no. And there is a very interesting famous paper by Wald, okay, in 80s most probably. So and then there are subsequent lot of work, and ultimately Wald and who is the another author? I don't remember the another author. Recently, they have proven by taking into consideration a lot of other things like back reaction of the particle, blah, 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 they have proven that this is not possible. At least by sending particle, okay, you cannot overcharge or overspin a black hole. Remember, this is not a proof of cosmic censorship conjecture. Why? Because this is just in a particular case for Carnot-Neumann black hole. Okay, there may be other cases. Okay, so this is a particular case, an illustration where counterexample seems not to exist. Okay, so there is a very interesting literature on this. There is a very interesting paper by Veronica Houvini where she considered almost extremal black hole, charged almost extremal black hole, and then try to answer this question, is it possible to add a little bit more charge to make it naked singularity? It turns out you can. Then it turns out that if you consider back reaction of this charge, you cannot. Okay. So there are interesting references. You can look for it. Start looking at the Veronica Houvini overcharging the black hole, and you will find all the interesting references. Okay. Is it okay? Is there any other question? If it is not, then I'll go into the studying null geodesics of Kerr black hole. Of course, we are not going to do it in full glory. Okay. This will be difficult. Okay. So geodesic null black hole. And Kerr black hole. Okay, so remember the geodesic equation is a second order differential equation. Okay, but the great thing about spherically symmetric problem is that independent spherically symmetric problem is that we had constants of motion, the first integrals, energy, angular momentum, in one wire potential, the so-called Lenz vector, etc., etc. And what they did is that using this first integrals, okay, I'm able to convert the second order differential equation into a first order differential equation. It's much easier to integrate. You can use this conserved quantities to write down first order differential equation. Okay. Now in Kerr case, what are the conserved quantity Kerr? Time translation invariance is there because it's a stationary solution. Invariance. And I have a conserved quantity, which is energy. Okay. Similarly, there is a phi invariance, the azimuthal invariance. Okay. In that case, at least the angular momentum along the direction of the z-axis, okay, Lz equal to P phi. Let's say P mu is the momentum of the photon. That's a photon momentum. Momentum. So phi component, this guy is conserved. Okay. Because of the del phi symmetry. Good. So I have two conserved quantities. There is no more conserved quantities. But the system is not spherically symmetric. So a priori, there is no reason to believe that I should be able to convert the set of second order differential equation for the geodesic into first order differential equation. But it turns out you can. Okay, and there is a remarkable fact, it can, because Kerr has a very interesting thing, something called a conserved tensor. Okay, and there is another conserved quantity, sometimes called the Kerr constant. I'm not going into those things, but it turns out that even for Kerr's case, it is possible to separate out r theta part of the equations, and a lot of interesting simplifications is possible thanks to the presence of that Kerr constant. Okay, but our aim will not be going to those details. Okay. What we will do is that simplicity, we will try to find what is the way of finding null geodesic in a particular plane for theta. See, earlier we can always take theta equal to pi by 2 plane because central force in spherical symmetry is planar. But now this is no longer case. Depending on which theta you are in, things will change. But I can always look for geodesics which remains in the theta pi plane. Theta pi. That means I look for, consider only the equatorial plane. Again, this is not the general case for Kerr at least. Okay. But let's for simplicity try to see how things looks in the equatorial plane. Consider equatorial plane. That means theta equal to pi by 2, and I set theta dot equal to 0. Okay. I'll set it. Okay. In that case, show that they will remain in the equatorial plane. But out of the system is no planar here. Okay. So it's an axisymmetric system. Okay. So physics will differ at different theta. You have to be careful. Okay. In that case, for this particular plane, the Lagrangian will be written as just like the Schwarzschild case, 2m by r. Sorry, my mistake, not r. This will be 2m by. No, this will be r because theta equal to pi by 2, rho is same as r. Okay. The cos square theta part in the rho has gone away. T dot minus 4am r t dot phi dot minus r square delta r dot square minus r square plus a square plus 2 a square m r phi dot square. Okay. Again, when I say dot, t dot, I mean dt d lambda, because I'm working on a null geodesic where lambda is an affine parameter, and etc, etc. Okay. What are the conserved quantities? Conserved quantities are, I write only the energy and the angular momentum, E equal to minus Pt, that is the way the definition is, and that is minus 1 minus 2m by r t dot, but there is now extra component, which is minus 2am by r phi dot. Remember in Schwarzschild, I had only this part. Okay. Now I have extra part because of the presence of angular momentum. Okay. Similarly, there is another conserved quantity, P phi. Okay. The photon momentum phi component. And that if you calculate 2am by r t dot plus r square plus a square plus 2a square m by r phi. Again, if you put a equal to 0, you go back to L by R square. Okay. For this. Okay. It's simple as this. Okay. Always remember that putting a equal to 0, this is R square into phi dot, which is exactly the angular momentum for the non-rotating case. Now you can calculate the PR, and the PR turns out to be R square delta by R dot. Okay. Good. Now what we look for is radial null geodesic equation. So you can obtain the radial null geodesic equation from this. Again, the condition is same. R and R dot, vary the Euler-Lagrangian equation for R and R dot, you will get the radial null geodesic equation. So let me write it down, the radial null geodesic equation. Geodesic equation. If you remember, this is what is important. Okay. It is a radial null geodesic equation, which for our Schwarzschild case gives us everything, effective potential, the existence of the unstable circular null geodesic, and from the unstable circular null geodesic we constructed the shadow for Schwarzschild black hole. Okay, we want to do the same game for the Kerr case. Okay, of course we can only do rigorously at theta equal to pi by 2. I will give you the reference where you can do it for other thetas, but in a power series form. I'll give you the reference which people have done it. And then if you do that, R dot square in this case will be given by E square plus 2m by R cube L minus AE whole square. By the way, a good reference for looking at this calculation is Chandrasekhar's book, Mathematical Theory of Black Holes. Okay. You can look at that book. That book has all the details of this calculation. Okay. Minus 1 by R square L square minus a square is square. If you put a equal to 0, it goes back to the ordinary equations which we have written in terms of effective potential, E and R dot square. So just put a equal to 0, you will see that this will go to R dot square equal to E square minus 1 minus 2m by R L square by R square. This is the Schwarzschild case. My mistake. Excellent. Okay. So the idea is that given this equation, we look for we look for the obvious thing, the unstable circular photon orbit. So we look for circular. So this is the radial equation for every photon. Okay, we want to impose the condition that r is not changing, circular, and there is also no velocity in the direction of r. So r dot is zero, and therefore there is no acceleration. So r double dot is also zero. So that now r dot is zero, it will zero everywhere at all the time. So therefore r dot and r double dot, I will set it to zero. Circular null geodesic. Geodesic set r dot equal to r double dot equal to zero. Okay. So you take this equation. This is an important equation. First set this equation to zero. Take the derivative of this equation. Obtain r double dot. Set the r double dot also to zero. Okay. And you get two independent equation. Let me write it down. Two independent equation. You will get equation e square plus 2m. So let's say this happens at r equal to rp. This is my photon. I should not say photon sphere anymore. It does not be a constant radius sphere, but you know what I mean. I can call it photon ring or whatever. Okay, rp plus 2m by rp cube l minus a e square 1 by rp square L square minus A square E square equal to zero. And the derivative will give me, this is two independent equation will give 6M by RP cube 4 to the power 4 L minus A E whole square plus 2 by RP cube L square minus A square E square equal to zero. Question is there a solution to this equation? So this is what my aim is to emphasis to you and convince you there will be a solution to this equation. I will tell you how to find the solution, and then I write down the solution for you, which will tell you at least in the equatorial plane there is a circular null geodesic. What happens off the equatorial plane, I'll leave it for you to explore. Okay, I'll give you the reference. Okay, now what you can do, so these equations are also very important. Call this equation to equation one, and this equation called equation 2. Okay. Now equation 1 immediately will tell you that this RP is 3m L minus AE by L plus A. Okay. Sometimes what we do is that we replace, again note that if put A equal to 0, we'll get R equal to 3m. The old Schwarzschild result. Okay. And you will see that this can sometimes written as 3m some d c minus a d c plus a. What is d c? The definition of d c is l by e. Convince yourself this is the impact parameter of the gel geodesic coming towards the, so if it come towards this impact parameter is the l by e. Okay, sometimes called the critical impact parameter, because for this it will come to r equal to RP. Okay, good. Then using this one can show equation 2 will give, so you get first this and put it into equation 2, you will give and another equation that e square equal to 1 by 27 m square. Again you will see put a equal to 0 by l minus a. You put a equal to 0, you will come back to the old result that e square equal to l square by 27 m square, which has to be true for null geodesics which come to the photon sphere. Okay, which forms the photon sphere. Remember, we did it in for the spherical element. This is the generalization of e square equal to l square by 27 m square for a equal to 0 case. Okay, good. What you can show is that this equation is further simplified and can be written into a form, a cubic equation dc plus a whole cube equal to 27 m square dc minus a. Again dc is l by a, impact parameter, critical impact parameter. you can define a quantity y equal to dc plus a, then this equation becomes equal to a cubic equation y cube minus 27 m square y plus 54 a m square equal to 0. Please check this algebra, okay? Now what is the, so let's box this equation, this is also important. So box also, this equation, okay? So call this equation 3 and call this equation 4, okay? So from 4, you can obtain a cubic equation, look for the real root, okay? Obtain real positive root, obtain y, okay? So this is something I leave it to you, okay? You use whatever method you want, find y from this equation. Then once you have y from this equation as a function of m and a, okay? M and a, you can obtain the y. Once you have y from this equation, then use equation 3. Look at equation 3. If you have y, so from y equal to, remember, y equal to dc plus a. So if you have y, you will have dc. You can put the value of dc to obtain rp. You understand that using equation 4, I can obtain y slash dc as a function of a and m. Once I have dc as a function of a and m, I can substitute into equation 3 and obtain rp as a function of a and m. See, that is ultimately I want. I don't want to keep the quantities like l and e into the equation. I don't know what is l and what is e of the photon, okay? I want to express everything as a function of mass and the angular momentum of the black hole, the background quantities, okay? That's my hope and aim, okay? So that is exactly what I want to do. What I'll do is that I will convert, use this equation to write dc as a function of a and m, and then substitute into equation 3 to obtain rp as a function of a and m. Now, when you do that, there are two cases to be considered. If you look at Chandrasekhar books, it tells you the retrograde motion when you are going in the opposite direction of the hole. Okay, the retrograde. You're going, the hole is going this direction, you are going in the opposite direction. The null ray is going this direction. And also there's a prograde relation, the direct orbit, which Chandrasekhar called, when you and the light ray are moving along the same direction. Schwarzschild case, there is absolutely no problem because it's spherically symmetric case, okay? But here, you have to be careful to consider two situations separately, and you get a solution rp plus minus equal to 2m 1 plus cos 2/3, again cos inverse, this is a bit tricky, minus plus a by m, okay? And where r plus p is for the prograde case when you are rotating with the hole, and r plus minus is the retrograde. Good. And here it tells you, so you put a equal to 0, you go back to your good old case of expand everything, try, so you will go back to your good old case of r equal to 3m, okay? Okay? So what you, I try to convince you, at the equatorial plane, there is also an unstable circular orbit. Well, by the way, I have not proven it to be unstable, okay? I just proven a circular null geodesic. So you need to do a little bit more work to prove it to us. So this is only in the equatorial plane. How do you go off the equatorial plane? But this is only in the equatorial plane. So it turns out how to go off the equatorial plane is a little bit difficult, okay? And I will not do this anything. I can tell you that at least for slowly rotating case, when a by m is less than, much, much less than one, one can write down an infinite series with respect to the angle of inclination and the ratio a by m, okay? In fact, we can define the inclination angle, inclination by using a quantity called cos I, where I is the inclination angle, okay? So the where equatorial plane is defined to be cos square I equal to 1. That is cos I equal to plus minus 1. That is I equal to 0 or I equal to pi. Okay. So this will be my equatorial plane. So either I'm looking at this cos equal to 0, this is the equatorial plane, or I'm looking at this. Okay. And what will be the polar orbit? The polar case, polar plane is defined as cos I equal to 0. Okay. So these are the two cases. So this is one plane, equatorial plane, and there is another plane, which is the polar plane. Okay. So this is the equatorial plane, and there is this. How do I draw the polar plane? Okay. So this is this plane, or you may think of this plane. Okay. I can think of these two planes by using an angle I. Okay. So any intermediate I, I'm off the equatorial plane. So I start from 0, go to pi by 2, I'm in the polar plane, come back to pi, I'm in the equatorial plane, and again go to 2 pi, I am in the, the polar plane. Okay. So this is I, this inclination angle is given by this cos I. In that case, one could able to show there is this very interesting paper by Shar Hod. And the paper, I'll give you the archive number. XIV, this is 1210.2486. Okay. Look at this paper. It gives you an infinite series. Okay. Of RP, the unstable photon orbit, circular orbit, as a function of A and cos I. It tells us that this is equal to 3m. Of course, when nothing is there, cos I, everything is less 3m. Then is 2 by root 3 cos I a by m. Remember, this is the case a by m much, much less than 1. Then the second term is 1 by 9 minus 4 plus 2 cos square I a by m whole square plus 5 root 3 by 81. I'm just writing this just to convince you that I can do it, a by m whole cube, and so on and so forth. Okay. So at least for slowly rotating case of the equatorial plane, one can prove there exists a photon radius and everything is well defined. Okay. So this reference you can look at. Okay. Good. So we have understood that at least in the Kerr case, there is an unstable circular polar spherical kind of photon orbit. The question is, but remember the radius is distorted. Okay. It depends on the angular momentum, and there is no spherical symmetry in the system. So we do not expect shadow. We expect shadow is not spherically symmetric. Spherically symmetric. So it turns out the Kerr shadow is not spherically symmetric. So I will show you a curve. In that curve, so let's look at this curve. This is the curve of Kerr shadow. Okay. What is this alpha and beta are kind of, you can think of projection coordinates in the sky. So you can think of sky to be a two-dimensional plane, and this projection coordinates are like alpha and beta. Remember, this is happening at the equatorial plane. Okay, so what you are looking at this plane of the paper is the equatorial plane for its cos, again, this plane, where cos I equal to plus minus 1. So it is 0 or pi, okay? So this is in the equatorial plane I'm looking at, okay? Now note that if A is 0, this is the spherically symmetric case, I have a perfect sphere. This is the case for the Schwarzschild black hole. If I increase A, go to A equal to 0.5, A equal to 0.99, 0.99 is almost extremal. Look at the shape has distorted. One side has distorted, and the other side you will have here. Look at this side versus this side and this side. There's an asymmetry when you're talking about this particular orbit. Okay. This orbit is asymmetric. existence of this asymmetric orbit is a telltale sign that there is a rotation in the system. Okay. Now, compare the actual shadow picture we'll get. This is the actual event horizon shadow picture, okay? So let's look at here, which is the direction of rotation. You can show that direction of rotation is like this, okay? Here you will see in one direction, there is a bulge. The other up, there is not a bulge. That means there is a rotation here also, and you can convince yourself it's something like this, okay? So this is the reason for having a shadow. When you look at backlitted light bended towards the null ray, for spherical symmetry, it's clear. I'll see a black disk. But for Kerr case, because of the rotation, the symmetry is broken. There is still an unstable null surface, okay, which I have convinced you that it exists. But the nature of the shadow is far more complicated, and there is an asymmetry. And this asymmetry signifies there is a rotation in the system. Note that one has to be a little careful in interpreting this picture. What I told you so far is simply a pure Kerr black hole. But in a general case, there has been a lot of gas, exodynamics, gas dynamics, all things are going on due to the presence of the accretion disk, the magnetic field, everything. So in principle, you should actually trace the ray in a general relativistic algorithm, considering the effect of the accretion disk and everything. This is what is actually done in the event horizon telescope simulations result, okay? And then compare that with the original picture, what you get in the observation, okay? So it's just not this null geodesic calculation. A lot of other coding goes on there, okay? So this picture has been taken in the 1.3 nanometer wavelength of light, which is almost infrared radiation. And also the size, the angular size is like 42 micro arc second. Okay. What is interesting is that if I can measure the radius of the shadow, think of these formulas. Okay. If I can measure the radius of the shadow, and if I have an independent estimate of capital M, I can estimate the rotation A. Okay. So this is remarkable. So what I can do is that by estimating the mass from same any other method, for example, M87, there are other estimates of mass from astrophysical methods. And once we know the radius of the shadow, the parameters of the shadow, radius, shape, and everything, I can use the independent estimate of mass to obtain the rotation of the central object associated with the shadow. And this is remarkable, okay? So this has been done, and it turns out still now all the data suggests that it is highly consistent with a rotating black hole mass of, I don't remember the value of the mass, is some very high mass of some, I don't know, 10 to the plus, I don't remember the exact number, huge, some several solar, 10 to the plus 6, 10 mega solar mass object, and with a very high rotating speed. A by M is almost like a 0.7. That is what you require to fit the data, okay? Again, let me emphasize certain points again. The existence of a shadow does not mean that we have a black hole. Existence of a shadow means there is an unstable circular null geodesy, which is there as long as there is vacuum till 3M or till R equal to RP. Beyond R equal to RP, what is happening? It depends on the physics. For example, you can have models, something called boson star, where is a boson condensate matter. You can have gravastar. Gravastar is something like a matter which is like a dark energy balanced by rho equal to minus p equation of state at the center of the star. Okay, all those can be a very compact and rotating. So outside space time looks like Kerr, and therefore we'll not be able to distinguish them just by measuring the shadow. Okay, but it is also true that for those stars, we don't know the dynamical evolution, how actually those stars are formed, boson star or gravastar, from the collapse of the matter is not very clear. Okay, the one which we know how the black hole forms very well. Not only that, there are interesting ideas in the literature. For example, there's a very interesting paper by Kunha and other, I have mentioned in the notes, which I have shared in the, I will share in the website. There may be theoretical reason for which the black hole is more preferred. It turns out if there are compact object but no horizon, which creates light ring or the photosphere or the shadow, for such objects, instead of along with the unstable circular null geodesic, there also be a stable circular null geodesic. And it turns out the stable circular null geodesic are not a good thing to have. Schwarzschild, we have an unstable circular null geodesic. But if I have a stable circular null geodesic, it turns out those are bad objects because they leads to nonlinear instability of the spacetime. So it sounds a bit paradoxical. The unstable ones are good. The stable null geodesic leads to nonlinear instability in the system, in the spacetime instability. Okay. I'm not going into more details. What it means is that if I'm looking at a shadow, we expect it is a stable shadow. So therefore, it came from unstable null geodesic. And therefore, it is not an ultra-compact object. It must be a black hole. Of course, jury is not finally out. Okay. There are a lot of work is going on. But what is important is that the existence of a circular null geodesic allows us to probe extremely strong field of gravity. Okay. Since we can understand and look at those circular null geodesic in the shadow, irrespective of what is the nature of the central object, this gives us a probe to study physics at very strong gravity. And that is remarkable. Okay. Because this is the time we can test general relativity with respect to other theories using this observation. So recently, a lot of such tests has come out. For example, the post-Newtonian corrections have been tested. People have tested different kind of black hole solutions in different theories by using this shadow observation. So therefore, this is a remarkable calculation, okay? Remarkable development. Good. So I'll stop here. I don't have much else to say, and I'll wait for more questions. Thanks. If there is a question, please let me know. Any questions, any doubt, any other topic also you can ask. I mean, some related, don't ask me about condensed matter physics. That's not a good idea. Related in general relativity, you can always ask a question. Good. So if there is no question, first of all, thanks to all of you for attending the course. We really hope that you have enjoyed the lectures. And if you have any physics questions, you are welcome to write me an email. We hope to organize more such school. Okay. Okay, can you talk about Noether theorem? The Noether theorem is a beautiful idea. So see, there is this Noether theorem and there is this uniqueness theorem. The basic idea is that, so look, there are only two long range quantities, three long range attributes to a black hole at infinity. These are mass, if there's a charge, and the angular momentum. Noether theorem says that's all. There is no more hair to the black hole. For example, if you say that, can I create a black hole, asymptotically flat vacuum black hole, by collapsing, let's say a massive electromagnetic field, or H mu nu, okay, tensor field. Tons of these answers are no. Or a scalar field, ordinary canonical scalar field, the answer is no. There is no asymptotically flat black hole solution arising from the sourced by a T mu nu of a scalar field. There is a very famous theorem. It is proven by Bekenstein first, and then there are a lot of extension. This Noether theorem shows that black hole, in some sense, is a very simple system. Okay, this word simple, you know, it doesn't mean really English simple. It means physics simple. It means that there are very few parameters required to classify or understand a black hole solution. Suppose I give you a star, okay. Suppose I give you a star, that star will have all possible moments, okay. It's some crazy thing, okay. It will have dipole, quadrupole, and whatnot. But when you collapse that star and you produce a black hole, it's a rotating curve black hole, attributed only by, described only by two numbers, mass and angular momentum. Of course, the first question you should ask, what happens to other moments? It turns out the other moments decays by gravitational wave and goes to thrown away to infinity. And there is something called Price's law, which tells us how this decay happened. Okay. But the final state is remarkably simple. No physics simple system is that simple as black hole. Again, the word simple does not mean English simple, it's a physics simple. That means you only require very few parameters to describe the solution, final solution, irrespective of what you have started with. Okay. So this is the power of the Noether theorems. The proof of the Noether theorem, quite interesting. There are certain exceptions of the Noether theorem also, like particularly the Young-Mills field. You can look for it. Okay. So, but in general, they shows that black holes are mostly Kurt-type. Then there's a question, why we define mass at infinity? That is because the gravitational field has no local energy momentum tensor. See, when I wrote down G mu nu equal to T mu nu, remember, this T mu nu is that of matter. Okay. What about the T mu nu of the gravitational field? For electromagnetic field, you can write down T mu nu of the electromagnetic field, F A mu, F nu A, minus 1/4 F squared G A B. Okay. Okay. So let me answer this question. So, okay. But for gravitational field, I cannot define the T mu nu of the gravitational field. Nobody, you know where you have seen that somebody has written that T mu nu of the gravitational field. Okay. This is very strange. This is because of the because there is no local, there is no conserved, there is no symmetric T mu nu of the gravitational field, which is a coherent object. Why? Simply because locally I can always get rid of the gravitation, because of the equivalence principle allow me to locally construct local inertial frame in which there is no gravity. That means T mu nu of the gravitational field should vanish at the local inertial frame. But if it is a tensor, it vanishes in local inertial frame, it vanishes in all frames. So that means you cannot have a covariant. You cannot have a covariant energy T mu nu for the gravitational field. And therefore you cannot define a charge or gravity using that T mu nu. Okay. The problem, this problem is coming from the fact that gravitational physics is actually diffeomorphism invariant. The bulk Hamiltonian of the gravitational physics, the Einstein's theory of gravity, vanishes when you impose the equation of motion. Okay. What is called the on-shell vanish. Everything is given by the boundary value of the Hamiltonian at infinity. Okay. So it is the boundary value of the Hamiltonian which determines the energy of the space-time, which is always evaluated at infinity. And this is what is called the ADM formalism. The ADM mass is the mass, total mass of the entire space time, whatever happening in the space time, but evaluated at one of the infinities. Okay. Well, everything is in the website. All lecture notes are in the website. Okay. If you look at the course content, day one, day two, day three, they are there. What is the difference between Penrose process and Hawking radiation? Hawking radiation is a quantum process. Penrose process is a classical object. Penrose process comes from this simple fact. Let's say this is horizon for the curve, and this is the ergosphere. So basically here, del T A is space-like. Okay. Remember, I can define energy as coming from the time translation invariance. But that assume the positivity energy assume that del T is time-like. Inside the ergosphere, del T is space-like. So I can have negative energy. Okay. So suppose I have an object which has E greater than zero for going into the ergosphere. Inside, I can create, so remember that I can go into the ergosphere and I can come back because this is not an event horizon, okay? And I can come back. But while coming back, I arrange the process that from E minus E energy goes into inside and 2E energy goes outside. Now you may say, how can this is possible? This is possible because the delta is space-like inside. So I can have a factory where I can create particles of minus E and particles of 2E. Total energy is conserved, no violation of conserved energy. So I can send particle E I can bring out particle 2e and by sending minus e into the black hole. That means I can, so one way to think of it is that you send a particle of certain energy gets the maximum more energy out of it. Okay. Now the question is that what happens to the black hole? This negative energy particle is absorbed by the black hole. And you can show what happens is that the black hole angular momentum decreases. Okay. So black hole slowly rotates more and more. What you are doing is basically extracting rotational energy of the black hole to you. Okay. It's a perfectly classical object. The wave analog of this is the what is called a super radiance. You send a wave, classical wave, and when it reflects from the black hole, it through the Argo region and then bring it back, this amplitude has enhanced. Okay. That is because it has extracted rotational energy from the black hole and ultimately it slowed down the black hole. How long this can continue? This can continue till the black hole is rotating. After that, there is no ergosphere. Everything merged into horizon and no more Penrose process, no more super radiance. Okay. A Hawking radiation is a completely different beast. It's a quantum mechanical process which arises when you study quantum field theory in curved space-time near a black hole. I'm not going to the Hawking radiation, but Penrose process is an interesting process. It happens because there is the existence of ergosphere. Okay, I have to stop now because there is a next lecture by Professor Sudhapa Roy. So thanks a lot for everybody for coming to this lecture and joining us. We really wish that you could have come to our campus and stayed with us. Nevertheless, keep touch with us, look at our website and keep contacts with all the faculties who has given the lecture, Sutapa, Arpan, as well as Prasanna. If you feel any of your research interests coincides with any of them, feel free to write to email to them. They are very helpful. They'll always reply to you. Okay, sometimes they may be a little busy and will be a little late. Do send them a reminder. And that's all. Okay. And read as much as you can. There are a lot of very interesting things. Okay. Thanks a lot. So I'm signing off.